Welcome back to Fast Market on the TD Ameritrade Network. I'm Tom White, joined by my co-host Kevin Hinks. But let's bring in our next guest for our cash tag segment. That's going to be Landon Swan, the co-founder of Likefolio.com. Thanks for joining us, Landon.
Good to be here, guys.
All right. So we're talking DoorDash. You know, I've got a real problem with this, the company, because when you order something on DoorDash here in the city of Chicago, Landon, I mean, a $15 burrito is now $30. I mean, it's crazy. And you hear all these stories about a lot of, you know, the restaurant owners complaining because they make no profit due to all the high fees that DoorDash not only charges them, but they're charging you too. Your thoughts here, what kind of data you're seeing on Likefolio? Is it slowing down as far as the number of people using these delivery systems?
Tom, you got to go out to the store. You can't just sit at home and have some $15 burrito delivered to you. But I tell you what, it actually matches with some of our data. You've got DoorDash at 44% happiness. Pretty low number there. Uber Eats is at 38%. Postmates is actually leading the pack at 62%. But still, generally speaking, people are fairly frustrated with either the price or the time. It seems like it's one or the other. It's hard to get both. And, you know, a lot of times it's not even their fault. Sometimes it's the restaurant that's backed up and you're not going to be able to do anything about that, or they've got too many orders per driver. So it's tough. It's a tough business, I think. And you've kind of seen why the stock has just been decimated since November. I mean, the DoorDash is down, I think, around 60% in just a few months. So it is really getting hit hard. And what's interesting, though, is that this is actually kind of the leader of the pack as far as purchase intent and revenue. They are the big winner in this. And despite having the lower happiness, they're leading the pack as far as purchase intent and revenue goes. Those numbers actually match up pretty well. So when we look at the total purchase intent picture, you can see here DoorDash is the monster. It's about 2/3 of when people are talking about food delivery, much bigger than all the rest. And again, this matches up very closely with revenue. I think revenue is around 58% for them. Uber Eats is right around 24% versus what we have, 21%. Purchase intent is very much in line with actual revenue when it comes to comparison. And so what's interesting is that you say, all right, well, how have they done? You know, if you look at Uber's recent earnings report and kind of look forward ahead to DoorDash's, it gives you an idea when you look at year over year, how the companies have done on a purchase intent basis. Uber Eats did okay, but DoorDash is actually holding a little bit better. Here we've got the generic food delivery. So this is, when we say generic, this just means people talking about getting food delivered, right? Usually, back in the day, it was only pizza, but now it's just food in general. You can see, obviously, when COVID was, and now that we're kind of back to normal, it's starting to trend, I guess, sort of in the wrong direction, right? If you think about what it was doing going into COVID, now it's reverting back to the mean and actually pulling down a little bit. We've actually got it down about 19% year over year. I think this just shows that people are less enthusiastic about it, that I think somewhat the novelty has worn off and people are excited about getting out there to restaurants, which have just begun to reopen over the last year. But when you compare how these companies have done on a year-over-year basis, you can see one is quite a big loser here. Postmates doing very poorly year-over-year. And a lot of these, obviously, they're down on a purchase intent basis, which I think points, again, towards the excitement or enthusiasm around using these. But DoorDash is holding the line as close as it can compared to the rest, and it's maintaining its large lead. So it is on every metric that we can, you know, look at, you know, as far as usage, DoorDash is the leader, very clearly the leader. Happiness, it is falling behind, but that probably has a lot to do with, you know, all the things that I mentioned before. So I think there it's a tough business to be in. Investors are starting to figure that out as they've seen the stock price really sell off. And you know, until you get something in the future where you don't have to pay the delivery people, it's automated, AI driving cars or something like that. Until you get something like that and you take a huge expense out of it, I think it's a tough business to be in because it's going to be expensive. You're not going to keep people happy, and you got too many X factors, external factors that you really can't control when it comes to how the, you know, the quality of the food or maybe the, even the quality of the driver. So tough business to be in, not one that I'm excited about being an investor in. I'm not going to touch this one. On the earnings score for the earnings that we've got coming up, very, very rare situation. We've got a plus zero. So this is exactly as neutral as Likefolio gets on this. I do think that DoorDash is clearly the leader in the space. So if you like this space, sure, I think they're the one to go with. But, you know, I don't really like this space. And frankly, the happiness at 44% gives me a lot of concerns moving forward. Just, you know, it's tough to keep business going strong if you've got customers that unhappy.
All right, Landon, I've got an assignment for Likefolio. I would like you to make a correlation between the blood alcohol level of the people ordering food and the price tag of the food they're ordering. Because for me to order a $30 burrito, I've got to be hammered for me to get that to my house.
That's so two burritos.
When I think about ordering food, I think this is young and buzzed young people, and I'd like to know the hours of when they peak out, right? Because I think this is the only time that delivery service ever comes to my house is when my son orders food late at night. The only time. So I think that this is, you're right. I think all your instincts on this, Landon, and your data are showing this. Their margins got better during the pandemic. Thank you, Captain Obvious. They better have gotten better, but they still weren't profitable during the pandemic. How is this company ever going to be profitable? You're talking about they're the best or the biggest in their group, right? Okay, guess what? That's like summer school valedictorian, Landon. I mean, it's really not a great group to be in, even though they're the best. So you're right. You shouldn't touch. I mean, I have a very hard time getting bullish about this name, other than maybe if all the news is bad, maybe something is positive. Landon, your thoughts?
Yeah, I think you could make an argument for a trade here. I don't like a long-term investment, but I absolutely agree. If you could make an argument for a trade with the stock selling off like it has, maybe they come out with something that is, you know, stops the bleeding and you can get a little bounce here. But I'm not interested in owning this a year from now. So this, if I did anything, it would be very short term. But I do think that, you know, just like you said, they had the perfect storm of just everything in the yes. world coming together to say, here, you need food delivered. This is it. I mean, people were locked in their homes, and it was just perfect for this company. And if you're not making money, if you're not absolutely thriving during perfect conditions, then how are you going to do well during imperfect conditions as we reopen and people enjoy going out? So, you know, it's a tough business to be in. And again, I really think it comes down to self-driving cars or something like that in order to get this to be profitable. And that, to me, you know, I'm an optimist. I love technology. It doesn't feel like it's right around the corner. So I love what they're doing as far as, like, you know, they've got flour delivery. They've got other items for delivery. They're, you know, they're trying to do different things. They're trying to innovate. But again, I think it's just a tough business. Just like you said, this is the summer school group, and maybe they are the best, but, you know, I'd rather invest in a company that is in a great sector and growing rather than one of these.
Yeah. Hey, Landon, it's cold here in Chicago in the winter. So all the restaurants around me deliver through DoorDash, so that's why I'll use those in the winter. But you made these comments that as the economies reopen, right, mandates going away, it's going to be spring here in Chicago in a couple weeks. That's when people go out. When you talk about, you know, this is the leader of the pack in a losing business where they're not making money yet. When you look at the outlook where the stock fell from 257 to where it is right now, I mean, there's still downside in this stock also, potentially down to zero if they never make money, right? And people stop using them and we get through this pandemic. But at the same time, you think this is a viable business that'll last?
Ah, boy. So, I mean, you know, when a stock's going up, people always talk about buy low, sell high, but you also talk about buy high, sell higher, right? Well, I think that can apply to the downside as well. And I completely agree. They're not that far off of their IPO price. They had a nice little run there during the pandemic, but they've given it all back. And you're absolutely right. This stock, it's a company that could go to zero. I mean, it's just a tough business. And, you know, if you're not making money, that can only last for so long. So I worry about it long term. If I were to trade this name, I would be maybe thinking a bounce here, but I wouldn't want to hold it for very long. I'd probably stay away from it. So I agree with you, Tom. I think it's a little bit scary of an industry to get in. And it's not a matter of do you want to invest in DoorDash or not. It's where do you want to put your money? There's opportunity costs. There's so many other companies out there to invest in, and one that is struggling to make money when it showed that it couldn't do so during the perfect opportunities, and now that's gone, and you know they're really struggling here. So in my opinion, I think you stay away from it and just kind of watch and see what happens. But really, one of the biggest things that concerns me is that consumer happiness number. You compare it to the peers, it's beating Uber Eats barely, but even Grubhub has beating them. Postmates is absolutely destroying them in happiness, even though that's a tiny percentage of revenue. So you got to look out for some of these competitors. And if it was a situation where DoorDash had the biggest revenue, the biggest purchase intent, and the happiest customers, then I'd be thinking maybe we could play a bounce. Who knows? Maybe they can turn things around. But they don't have that happy of customers right now. So I'm very concerned with that, even though they've, you know, sort of lost the least amount when it comes to, you know, consumer enthusiasm for their products, as this chart shows. I still think that the happiness is very, very concerning. And as restaurants start to open up, you know, it's people are going out to eat instead of ordering in. So this seasonality is coming and we're on the cusp, just like you said, of springtime all over, where it's going to get a little warmer. People are going to want to go out more instead of delivering in. But to your point, Kevin, they're still going to be drinking at night. So they'll get those $15 burritos delivered for $30 total. I think that's probably their wheelhouse.
Yeah. All right. Great stuff. And that was one of the things that surprised me, Landon, is that the year-over-year purchase intent still high for DoorDash, even though the happiness is extremely low for this company. So I don't know. I it could be zero. It could be 150 tomorrow. Who knows? I mean, you just don't know, based on the fact that they need to get autonomous driving probably for them to be profitable. And now with inflationary pressures on everything that the restaurants use at this point, everything's going up, gas prices included. So we'll have to wait and see on that. All right. Great stuff as always, Landon. Have a great day. Go sit outside and eat somewhere down there in Florida. We can't do that yet here, but we will in a couple months.
Awesome. Yeah, I do it pretty much every day, guys. But one more point before we hop off.
Yeah.
AI, you know, once you get that automated driving, that is a game changer for this whole industry. So I think that's really the play if you're betting on this company long term, that you think that's going to happen sooner rather than later. Once you get that, then all these companies become instantly profitable and very viable. Until then, it's quite the gamble. Thanks, guys.
Yep. All right. Great stuff. As always, that's Landon Swan, the co-founder of Likefolio.com, giving us the sentiment and data on DoorDash ahead of earnings. Okay, Kevin.